All right, the title for this talk is Some Social Problems and the Aquarian Age. And this is the Libra to Aquarius talk. And Libra is the sign of the scales, and they are the scales of justice and of law. And it is through the law that there is continuity or connectivity within time. The opportunities of one day are the consequence of the days before it, and they are the cause of the days that come after it. There are, of course, always new things that enter in, so that one day is not the same as the next, but that's getting a little far afield, though we are going to talk a bit about newness tonight. In the last talk that we went through, we very lightly touched on some problems and paradoxes about the mind. And we were looking at the relationship of Gemini to Aquarius. We're looking at the trine relationships. Now, this is a very different kind of talk. It's more of a meandering talk, but there is some hint of the inversion that takes place when spirit is focused through the center of being, which happens to be located in the center of mind, and some of those things will come back up. Now, Libra is the sign of turnarounds. If you're going through the zodiac, beginning with Aries, when you come to Libra, you are as far away from the beginning as you can get, and it is a turnaround. And this is something like what our situation is in evolution. We are as far from our spiritual home as we are going to be within the entire evolutionary creation, and we are now at a turnaround. For this reason, some people, I can't comment on this because I don't have definite knowledge, some people believe that Jesus, who took in the Christ spirit, was born under the sign Libra because it represented a complete turnaround. Now, with a Libra turnaround, one sees things a different way. One sees things in an opposite way. We're talking about the sign of marriage and partnership. And with Libra, you see the world through the eyes of the partner. Not only the world, but you see yourself through the eyes of your partner. So with this perspective, things are reversed. And sometimes that is a little bit unpleasant, because from the personal perspective, we have built into our consciousness all kinds of things to defend ourselves and protect ourselves, and we're not always willing to sacrifice that personal point of view. So when we're talking about turnarounds and marriage and things like that, these are issues that come up. What we live in is a conservational unity. Everything in the one is recycled. It's a closed system. And in that kind of a system, when one loses, another one gains. So there is a connectivity of that type also in Libra. It's like the seesaw. One side of the seesaw cannot go down with the other side not going up. So it's with great wisdom that in the cosmic mandala, Libra, which loves and lives for the other, is a sign of sacrifice. It's willing to go down so that the partner can go up or that things can go forward. Now, in the talk preceding this talk, we had talked about, and the whole nature of the talk had a quality of mental tension about it. It has to do with Gemini, and Gemini is polarity, on and off of switches and things of that nature. Now that we're dealing with a sign that is ruled by Venus, there is more relaxation. We're tense when we argue, but when we share with others, we're talking about the house and sign of sharing, there is relaxation. Also, because this is a turnaround principle and because it is more relaxed, it means an easier talk for you because there's probably not very much content in everything that's going to be said tonight. And this will probably be the most light talk of the whole 25 talks that we're going through. When I relax, I usually go to stories. I have a personal library that is filled with literature of all different types, all different kinds of stories. And it isn't often that I allow myself to relax from obligation. I have the sun in the second house, and so I have a very obligatory kind of consciousness, and I feel guilty if I am not fulfilling my obligations. But when I do, I start reading stories. Not too long ago, for the 200th anniversary or the 100th anniversary of Jorge Luis Borges, I read all of the stories of Borges. And he was probably one of the best creative thinkers of the 20th century because he wrote stories, interesting stories. He has one called The Babylon Lottery, in which, in a very literary way, in telling a story, he deals with the problems of determinism and randomness and the interjection of freedom better than any 20th century philosopher has dealt with them, because they've never taken all of those things into context at the same time. He has other stories where he deals with objectivity and subjectivity. And he has an interesting one about people, or especially one individual being the source of intelligible light in the world. And it's most fascinating. He even talks about one-word poems, which harkens back to the one word of creation. But at any rate, I love to read mythology and fairy tales. And they're sort of a favorite of mine because they have a lot of spiritual meaning in them which needs disclosure to be taken away from too much symbolism without taking away the wonderful feel that you get in a story. And of course, all of the fairy tales have morals to them. I love the stories like Cronos swallowing all of his children, and Prometheus, for example, stealing fire from the gods and bringing it to humans, and for his reward he gets chained to a rock, and all day long a eagle chews at his liver, and every night it gets regenerated. They're really interesting stories. In fact, I believe probably the entirety of spiritual philosophy, the story of the creation of the cosmos, could be done in story fashion. Plato and the Platonists came pretty close to doing that, and fortunately they did a lot of interpretation. The abstract or the meaning behind the story is what is important. It is what gives life. It's almost like food. We can't take in food that is pure, concentrated nutrient because we could not absorb it. We could not digest it. We need roughage as part of it, and the undigested part of our food is as important as the digested part. So let's begin in our relaxed meandering through an idea or a set of ideas. Let's begin with a story. It's a little story, And it's a peculiar thing because I don't know any stories about the kidneys, because Libra rules the kidneys, and I wanted a story that had to do with functions of the body. And so I had to settle for a story about the stomach, which is ruled by Cancer, which is not so bad, because Cancer has its own kind of sacrifice. It isn't exactly the same thing as a Libra sacrifice. It's a story probably good for me anyway, because sometimes I think that my God is in my belly. It's a very brief story, and it's not very laden with meaning. You can find it in various parts of the world. One of the simpler versions of it is in Coriolanus by Shakespeare. And the story could be called The Defense of the Stomach. And it starts out when the heart calls a meeting of all of the parts of the body. And the purpose of the meeting is the prosecution of the stomach. Of course, the head wanted to call the meeting, but that's the way Aries and the head are like. But the heart, ruled by Leo, prevailed and ruled the meeting. The legs started out by saying, I walk, I run, I dance, I move the body everywhere, but the stomach gets all the food. And the feet said, I support the body until I am in pain, but the stomach gets all of the food. And the head said, I think, I see, I hear, and I direct everything, but still the stomach gets all of the food. And it went on like that. The lungs said, I inflate and deflate. It's almost like a children's song. Each one comes up and sings their little piece. And I pump until the body is almost breathless, but yet the stomach gets all of the food. Now, by the time all of the parts of the body had testified, there was quite a bit of evidence, and there was a lot of statements against the stomach. However, the stomach had plenty of stomach, and it spoke out its defense, and defense is a posture for Cancer, and so it was capable to rebuke its accusers. In its defense went something like this. It says, yes, I get all of the food. I swell with it. I toss it around. I mull over it. And when I'm done with it, it isn't even recognizable as all the things that went into me. But I keep none of it. I pass it on to the rest of the body. Of course, there would be other counter arguments for that, but what happened is that all of the other parts of the body were so stunned and they were so ashamed that they didn't say anything. And that was the end of the arguments against the stomach. And they never again raised the issue. All right, that's a story that has very little to do with what we're talking about tonight, but it's a nice little story. With the sophistication of Libra, we can appreciate the value of the stomach, or better said, of the digestion. Digestion is a very complex process on the physical plane. Even the chemistry of it is quite amazing, because the food starts out, when it gets to the stomach, it's in a completely acid environment. And by the time it gets out of the small intestine, it's in a completely alkaline environment. Meaning to say that we have two pHs in the alimentary canal. Meaning this is quite a remarkable chemical feat to do this within one living organism. When we look at digestion spiritually, it is both simpler and at the same time more complex. Now, our waking self-consciousness is very beautiful, and we appreciate it. And we appreciate waking consciousness and awareness so much, and we are preoccupied with it to the point that we don't realize how limited it is. We think that our waking self-consciousness is the totality of our consciousness. And that assumption is an illusion. There is much more to our spiritual being than our waking self-consciousness. There are various grades of consciousness within our being, both above and below, subconscious and superconscious parts of our being that we are ignorant of. So, there is an unconscious part to the digestion of food and to a lot of other biological processes. They go on by themselves, seemingly automatically, but they are under the direction of the entire intent to live of the spirit, and it keeps those things functioning. And so the spiritual presence is working and growing and experiencing, even though we may not be fully aware of that part of what's going on in our being. It's almost instinct-like, and it's a kind of intelligence that we wouldn't associate with waking consciousness. But there are responses to everything that is needed. When we digest food, as soon as we take it into our mouth, some of it goes immediately into the bloodstream, and that tells the consciousness, or the control of the consciousness then knows what kind of digestive fluids have to be put into the stomach for that food. There are all kinds of things like this that are happening all of the time. In the time that I said that last sentence, all of us produced hundreds of millions of red blood cells. Physiology is wonderful, wonderful to study. Every page that you turn over is a new miracle. Now, the spiritual philosophy, like the philosophy of the Rosicrucians, gives examples. And they are examples that should cure us of this illusion of having all of this self-consciousness and it being so great. The reality is that our self-consciousness is probably like a tiny isle in a vast ocean of our general consciousness. This gives us plenty of incentive to what we can wake up to and what we can make ourselves free in, rather than acting in instinctual-like ways. Now, we can throw a curve at this process. I remember one time, it's about 44 years ago, I threw a curve at my digestive process. I ate a half-green banana, hulled sesame seeds, and a little bottle of Welch's grape juice, and I had a stomachache that I can remember until this day. That's really quite something. That's talking a little bit about the complexity of digestion, the consciousness that controls it that we're not even aware of and does all sorts of complex things. But there are also simple things about the digestion. Esoteric students know that digestion is twofold. There is the chemical digestion, which we have just been speaking of, and there is the etheric digestion. And there's a complication even in this simple difference. The two types of digestion are incompatible with each other. For chemical digestion, cooking food makes it more easily digestible. You know, for people who eat meat, I wouldn't think of it, but for people who eat meat, it would be a very difficult thing to eat raw meat. It's, you know, it's hard to overcome that. But the etheric digestion, the vitality in live foods, is a totally different kind of digestion, and the vital life is driven out of food by the heat process. We need to have live, vital foods. When U-boats first came out, the Germans sent the pride of their navy out for several months in a U-boat with completely processed food. Nothing live whatsoever. They came back and most of them were crippled and malnutrient, and quite a few of them never got their health back. It's just one of those things that we cannot live without live foods. Some people who are etheric healers that are sometimes called magnetic healers, take an abundance of etheric energy into their body. They do that by taking milk straight out of the cow so that the energy has not had a chance to dissipate. Or some people do the same thing with vegetable juices, where there's fresh pressed vegetable juice has a considerable amount of vital life. When I was married, my wife was a very sensitive person. She used to drink carrot juice, and she'd say, "I feel new hair coming out of my arms." She could feel the energy coming out from the etheric body through the skin. Now, not all of the things about etheric and chemical digestion are mutually exclusive. There is a spiritual principle that applies to the digestion, absorption and assimilation of food that is called the law of assimilation. It is a principle that goes something like the following statement, which I actually have written out. One can only absorb and assimilate foodstuff into one's body that one has overpowered from the form that it is in, the form that was produced by another living being. And we can only keep it in our bodies as long as we can keep it under our overpowering assertion of will. It's a very interesting principle. There are interesting corollaries that come out of it. The idea is that since animals are at a much different level in the evolutionary creation, the animal kingdom is one step down from us, just the same way we are one step down from the angelic kingdom. And for that reason, they do not have that same strong will, and they do not benefit from taking in food from human beings. They can attract some of the ethers and some of the ionization, but they cannot overpower the food, and they cannot keep it in them. It's an interesting thing, because a lot of animals, such as tigers, the claim is in India that almost all tigers that are man-eaters are possessed, that somebody has taken over their body and is trying to get food in that way. Now, this relationship of the principle or the law of assimilation produces some very interesting interdependence between kingdoms. This doesn't sound anything like social problems, does it? We're pretty far away from everything. It is a creative principle that during involution, as we go deeper and deeper into matter, and there are more and more ramifications with each world deeper that we go into matter, we cannot do everything, because there's too much. And so the deeper we proceed into matter, the more we have to sacrifice some things in order to develop other things, because we are not, universally all-powerful. Now, the example of this is the transition between the plant kingdom and the animal and human kingdoms. The plant kingdom has the ability to take minerals as nutrients. Animals and humans cannot do that. Pure minerals, the ions we can use, but pure minerals as food, we can't use them. They're basically poisons to our body. And another part of this is that because the plants do not have motivation, they have nothing to curb the vital forces in them. So every plant that lives, as long as it lives, it grows. So the principle is that in order to have internal motivation, so that we could motivate ourselves, that is to have a desire body, an aura, which some people call it, we had to sacrifice the ability to take life directly from the sun out of sunlight. Now, of course, at some time in the future, we'll get that ability back again, and we'll get it back in a much higher way, but that's way beyond what we're talking about here. So when we're talking about these things, because there are things we cannot do, we have to then depend on kingdoms below ourselves. And that makes a wonderful interdependence. Everything needs the plant kingdom. The animals and the humans cannot go on without it. And so the plant kingdom, beside having its own experiences of building new bodies and experiencing the environment in different ways, provides a service. It gives the vitality for everything that lives. Everything in the cosmos gives some kind of service. Now, there are all kinds of things to this that are really interesting. For example, in herbalism, if you want to use an herb as a medicine, you don't sip it and run it in your mouth because that digests it. You want to keep the property of the herb that is medicinal intact in its state to do what it's going to do. So if you look at herbalists who have been around for a long time, they recommend gulping your herbal tea as soon as it's cold enough to do that. So this, you know, I'm so far afield that I'm not sure I'm going to be able to get back to all of this. This also tells us another reason why it is unwise to eat animal flesh as food. In the first place, it's not very good for compassion, because since the animals do have the desire nature, and they also, like humans, quit growing once the desire function comes into place, they can feel things. And so the animals suffer when they are killed wantonly and unnecessarily. But there's another reason, that since the animals are in a milieu of survival and in reproduction, the animal flesh is permeated with desire for those very things, violence and sexual reproduction. And if you're taking in animal food, you're taking in as part of that those desires. And before that food can become part of you, you have to overpower it. And you have to keep it in your power, or it's not going to do you any good. But now I've forgotten where we're going. If we look at this principle, the whole idea is then that, without looking at a number of factors, it's a very good thing to eat things low on the evolutionary chain, because they're easiest to overpower and they're most likely to stay with us a long time. Then, by that kind of assumption, algae would be an excellent food. In fact, I try to use algae every day. I eat spirulina, and I don't eat much, but I find it to be a very excellent food. All right, we've noted here several times that while we're talking about diet, that we as human beings, each of us is an entire kingdom. Each of us is a universe. And for complete expression of our being, it's important that we have variety. One of the weakest factors in the 21st century typical American diet is lack of variety. And because of that, various different foodstuffs are missing and various different qualities that go with those foodstuffs are missing. It is an important thing to keep in mind because most people do treat food almost like a religion, and challenging somebody's eating habits is like challenging their belief in God. But back on the statement from just a few seconds ago, each person is a kingdom. And each person as a kingdom is unique. And quite often we are significantly different. As all of those of you who are married know, that you're very different from your spouse. And so it's an important principle that there is no one diet for every person. Doctors find out that giving the same medicine in the same dose to two different people will have much different effects. And it isn't just a matter of how big the person is and how big their metabolism is. It's that each body functions differently. So there is no diet that is right for everyone. And each person should find their own diet and work with what their body likes or what their character likes. There are general principles that apply to everyone, but there is no one diet that is right for everyone. In fact, even for each person, there is no one diet. Because I'm finding now that with aging, the amount of food and the kind of food that I eat is very different than 20, 25 years ago. And it is for this reason that we have this statement about the ancient Iranians that goes, one man's Mede is another man's Persian. All right. We're finally getting to the theme now. There is another kind of digestion that is very engaging, and it is fascinating. And there are a lot of things that are fascinating, especially when the unconscious part of our being makes itself known in ways that we would never guess. Like, for instance, cravings. Like a woman going through pregnancy wanting to eat laundry starch or something like that because she needs it. And then there are all the complexities of what our desire urges and what are real cravings and things like that. But there's a kind of digestion that I find the height of all digestion. And it is called autolysis, which really literally means self-digestion. Autolysis in the plant kingdom is what is responsible for fruits ripening away from the tree. Like bananas taste better if you cut them when they're green and they ripen away from the tree. Provided you don't puncture the skin, the ripening process will go on in an excellent way away from the plant, and it's due to an autolysis that is set into motion. For fruit like apples, which are ruled by Libra and Venus, this indicates a time in the future when our creations will stand outside of us and they will be life, they will live on their own and they will be independent. That period is in fact even called the Venus period. Those things are, you know, the hints of that are given to us right now. Autolysis is found in the animal kingdom when animals undergo long fasts, such as hibernation or estivation. What usually happens is the animals digest fats in stores that are in the liver and in other organs, but primarily the liver, and they work themselves through a long winter or a long summer, depending on whether it's hibernation or estivation. But autolysis is found in the most wondrous of all processes, metamorphosis. Going as far back as we can go in history, metamorphosis has been spiritually inspiring to all spiritual investigators. It is when a worm or a caterpillar sews itself or weaves itself into a cocoon or a chrysalis and transforms itself. It completely transforms itself into a moth or a butterfly. And it does this by a very extensive and a very radical autolysis. And it never stops during the entire process. Most of the, or part of the digestive system and part of the control system remain the same, but otherwise everything else is digested and turned into something else. If that isn't a wondrous symbol or metaphor for the whole spiritual process whereby we take the lower parts of our being and transform them into something beautiful and wonderful, I don't know what is. It's astounding when you look at a butterfly or moth and you see those brittle little legs and the sensitive antennae and those glorious fragile wings that do things with light that engineers can't even figure out how they do it. Do you know that there are engineers that burn butterfly wings? Because the butterfly wings work with light and heat in such a way that they would love to be able to dissipate heat in computers with the efficiency that that it is done on butterfly wings. And so they burn butterfly wings to see how it's done. And this is for the advancement of science, I guess. But at any rate, it's a miracle. Everything is, stays in that cocoon, which doesn't get any bigger, and those legs are bent into the right place, the antennae are bent into the right place, and then it eats its way out and it unfurls the wings. And all of that out of a worm or a caterpillar. That's really an inspirational. In this talk, we're trying to talk about autolysis and metamorphosis in a different way, in relationship to our inner work and our way into the Aquarian Age and some of the problems we encounter along the way. In a number of these talks, we've been speaking about cosmogony, which is the birth of the cosmos, and cosmology, which is the orderly process through which the cosmos develops. And we've been talking about epigenesis, where creative beings, as humans are beginning to be, we're joining the gods in epigenesis, which is bringing new creations into the whole process so that it isn't just a cut and dried unfoldment of what was there all along. Almost simplistically, we have tried to show how all began with a very simple state, and that it became more and more concentrated and more materialized and condensed, and things became more complicated as forms reached up toward the spirit that created them, and the spirit reached down towards its form until it entered through the center of being, and we are now in our vehicles and we can look out at the universe and see it at the glory of the creation outside of us. We have noted that all of this detailed experience is necessary to bring out all the different facets of our becoming being as divine spiritual creators. It's necessary that we have all of these experiences and that none of these experiences be lost. Everything, all of the seemingly unnecessary nothings of our lives become useful. Of course, some things we could use more, be more tendentious about our lives, but we aren't. Now, last time we spoke about cosmic regression and forward progress. We spoke about a backward looking that is superimposed on the forward going process of evolution. We used the metaphor of a wheel which, when spun at just the right speed, is still going forward, but the spokes look like they're going backwards. That image is something like our looking back at life at the same time we're going forward, and when we do that, we live life more efficiently because we can see from the past how our conditions are now and where they're going in the future. And so the looking back is superimposed on the looking forward. And we're saying that this is a process that works throughout the entirety of the creation. We started looking at the interlocking spirals of the caduceus of Mercury. One serpent backing into matter and being an involutionary serpent, and the other serpent working its way out of matter and back into spirit. And between the involution, when we are creatures and everything is done for us by the gods and we are worked on by the gods to the point where we become creators and we give where previously we had received, we have to take the leap of faith. The tails of the two serpents do not meet. They're there, and we take the leap of faith and we enter into a life as creative beings. We've been using the astrological mandala as the grand symbol, astrological symbol, for everything in the universe from the human point of view. We have been, especially last time, looking into the ideas and principles behind all of this, using geometry as a symbol of abstract principles of creation. We have been looking at, in this entire series of talks, we are looking at how one sign of the zodiac relates to Aquarius and how it brings out different issues of the Aquarian age. We've looked at various different signs one by one, and this time we're looking at progress of going forward in time in the zodiac. Last time we spoke about the relationship, the trine relationship of Gemini to Aquarius. And the purpose of that was simplicity and perfection. This time we're going to use the trine again with a few other themes, and we're going to look a little bit more deeply into the air signs. Last time we started with the beginning of the mandala, the Aries point, and we followed its triangle to the ultimate, which is the cusp of the sign Sagittarius and the ninth house. We said that the initial raw action of Aries, by the time that it was perfected and got to Sagittarius, was purpose. And through that, we understood that the principle of the trine finds purpose. We then took and put the cosmic triangle on the earth signs to prove out and to elucidate the principle a little better. We said that the second house in Taurus, which rule possession, We said that possession finds purpose in use, and that use is, you know, you can't just be hygienic and be healthy. You have to have a goal or an aim, so you train to an end. So use finds purpose in a goal. But when you're at the top and you have reached the height of humanity and you don't want to come tumbling down, you have to find purpose for being on the top, and that brings you right back to being productive. And we use that as an example for understanding the principle of finding purpose through the trine. Now, we're looking at the air signs when we're looking with the trines, because Aquarius is an air sign and the elements are associated with the trine. Now, there are other kinds of purpose. You know, last time we saw that we looked with Mercury being the first of the air signs. We said that all of the air signs had intellection as part of their activity. This time we want to look at something else in order to understand the air signs, so that we can understand the Aquarian Age, so that we can understand what we're living in. Uranus is the principle of the greatest raw creativity. It's an intuition that is whole and true, and it doesn't need any explanation. It's something completely new, and in that regard, it is raw creativity. It's something heretofore never seen. Neptune intuition, for example, is very complicated, and it has all kinds of explanations and things like that. So if we're looking at Aquarius, we can see that one of the important things of Aquarius is creativity. Let's look at intellectual creativity. Gemini represents polarization, and it represents contrast. Libra represents loving attachment. It represents a compensation, or it represents a fulfillment. So it represents comparison. Uranus, or Aquarius, represents creative synthesis. That's what we're trying to get at. The third house in Gemini represent communication, getting the facts across. Libra represents sharing or sacrificing. Aquarius represents total unification in friendship. Mercury in Gemini makes very simple tools. In fact, it's not particularly a sign of beauty. So what happens is Libra brings in beautification. It brings in aesthetics. It makes something pleasant to look at. Aquarius brings in invention. It adds a spiritual meaning or understanding. It isn't just a simple expediency, and it isn't just pretty. It is that there is a meaning to all of these things, and that becomes important. We can see then that what is done by Gemini in the third house works with differences. Arguments are differences. What works with Libra is similarity. It is liking, or bringing things into a state of likeness with each other. But with Aquarius, what is brought in is a total understanding. There is a wholeness about things. And holism, which is act without the W, is actually an old word, but it hasn't gotten much press until just recent years, as people are becoming more aware of the Aquarian Age. Now, last time, we talked about the relationship of Gemini to Aquarius, which is a 240-degree relationship. This time, we're looking at the relationship of Libra to Aquarius, which is a 120-degree relationship. So before we can go further, we have to go right back to the beginning again and try to understand what the basic, simple 120-degree relationship is so that we can work with that. So we go right to the first cusp. And the first house is the initiation of anything. It's the moment of birth right here, and this is early childhood. This is the past from the immediate past life, if we're looking at the houses. So if we're setting out to do something, like we're going to write a poem, the initial urge saying, I'm going to write a poem, is ruled by the first house. When you get your materials together, that's like the second house. When the third house is when you have beginner's luck and you've got your basic skills and can do a few things. And then you go to incubation. But in the fifth house is when the poem is completed. It's full, it's fulfillment, it's attainment, it's accomplishment. So, in terms of Libra, Aquarius is an attainment or a fulfillment or an accomplishment of what is begun with Libra. Now, in words or terms that we've been talking about, we should see creative fruitfulness in the relationship between Libra and Aquarius. But what kind of fruit? To look at the kind of fruit, let's again look at some simple astrology. I hope that you're understanding that this is not meant to be purely astrological, but it's helpful to understand things using this as a universal symbol, so there's going to be some astrology. In the pictorial zodiac, let's look at the pictorial zodiac, Gemini is represented by two twins, arm in arm, Castor and Polydeuces. One of them mortal, one of them immortal, but they share the immortality such that when one is alive, the other one is dead. Libra, in the pictorial zodiac, is Themis, the blindfold goddess of justice. She has her eyes closed for impartiality, and that's one of those peculiar things that a thing and its opposite are in the same sign. Libra is the sign that loves to have pets, favorites, but at the same time, it strives for impartiality. Aquarius is Ganymede, the water bearer, who very carefully pours out his water, but only so much at a time. The thing that is in common between all three of the air signs is that they all have humans in their picturing, human figures. So what we're talking about are human values. We're talking about human interactions. We're talking about social values. And certainly for Venus, that is social values, meaning people being brought together by love. Venus, you might say, is the social lubricant of society. A love of people doesn't have to be necessarily deep. All it has to do is be genuine. And it puts people at ease, it relaxes them, it brings them together and finds them to be more attractive to each other. All right, now let's look at the symbols of Gemini, Libra, and Aquarius. They have something in common between them, and that is they all have horizontal parallel lines. The equals sign. In spirit, then, what is represented by the air signs and the analogous houses is the idea that we are all equal in spirit. There's even a folklore that says this so perfectly that, you know, you just wonder how these things come into humanity. You've all heard the statement, we all breathe the same air. And it's just as clear can be. Now this all bears up with the airy sign houses. The third, the seventh, and the 11th houses represent opportunities for interhuman interactions as equals. It's not like the relationship of a parent to a child, or a teacher to a student, or a mentor to a follower, or anything like that. This is among equals. So the ultimate purpose, the ultimate sign, Aquarius, is freedom. But it isn't there at the beginning. Brothers and sisters are ruled by the third house, and parents really do try to treat them by equals. Neighbors are ruled by the third house. Mercantile associations are ruled by the third houses. There is, you know, you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. The seventh house represents partnerships, especially marriage partnerships. The partnerships are made in freedom, but there is still need there. You need the other person, if only for childbearing, I don't like looking at it that way. But the Libra sign is not completely two parallel lines. There is a point that is missing. That is the fulcrum point. That is everything, the point of law, it is called. It's called res in legal terms. Aquarius represents friendships, even international friendships. Something that is done for its own sake. A person would bend over backwards for friendship. You can't make your brother not be your brother. You can marry someone freely, but when you're married, you're legally bound. But friendships are always free. You are friends with someone because you freely love them and want to be their friend. So those are the social relationships we want to look at, especially with regard to Libra. The Libra symbol, as we just said, is not completely accurate because the fulcrum is missing. The fulcrum, or that pivotal point, is a very sharp point. It's often a crystal in a very accurate scale. The beam rests on it, and it is a crux. It's a horizontal crux. Saturn is exalted in Libra, and its exaltation is being accurate to the very last jot and tittle. All sides of the law, all sides of both sides of the scale share that common central point. Libra comes after Virgo. If we follow the development of a society, this is a pioneering state. This is when people become landed. This is when boundaries and weights and measures are established. This is when a family situation develops, and out of the family situation comes children. And when you have children, you have free labor and a specialization of labor. But when you have a specialization of labor, then you have to have a legal system. And so we're talking about fairness under a legal system. When you develop a legal system, civil law, you sacrifice. It's no longer like Aries on the frontier is every man for himself and let the best man win and all of those kinds of things. I hope that we don't have any Aries here that are of the more sophisticated variety that would be upset by that. So we can see then that one enters, when there's a civil law, there is a philosophical term for it, one enters into social contract. Seventh house is a house of contracts, and the most important one is an unwritten one that finds its way into all of the legal code, and that is the basic social contract. The personal individual sacrifices rights for the collective good of all. Social contract is based on points of mutual agreement. Those become social fulcra. We can even say that the contract withers without being held together by commitment to it. Once we fell into materialism and separation, especially the separation of the sexes, specialization demanded cooperation. Half of our creative energy had to be used for sharing bodies with procreation. On a higher parallel level, what happened at the same time as the separation of the sexes was a change in the individuality. And it was a more fundamental change, so that there are two types of human beings. According to the biblical story, there are the children of Cain and the children of Seth. They are the children of fire and the children of water. They have two totally different temperaments, and they maintain those temperaments through all of their lives. No matter how many times they're reborn, they have that basic stamp. The children of fire are people who are Freemasons. They are people of works. The children of water are called Catholics, and they are children of faith. We're not talking about the free and accepted Masons that meet downtown or the Catholic Church or anything, but those are representatives of something much bigger. So that in this, in the same way that by cooperation from the separated sexes, new personalities are born, in that same creative stroke, new individualities were begun, and each has a flavor that is all its own. The ultimately, the individuality is to be wed to the personality. This is the alchemical wedding. This is the divine wedding, where spirit and matter come together and carry out the work of creation with waking consciousness after that. We've talked about this in the past. We've said that human beings jumped the gun as far as procreation is concerned, and that we have plunged ourselves into material darkness, and we have made it difficult for the spirit to enter into the personality, because we have developed in the personality a lower nature or a second self that inhibits the development of the spiritual individuality. When we took this act of creation into our own hands, we became free beings, and the gods could no longer lead us around willy-nilly. We were free on our own. We are helped by indirect influences, like astrological influences, and things like cultural spirits and race spirits and things like that, that bring us to ultimate individuality. In the same way that there is a parturition of a personality, of a body in the womb, there is also the same in the development of an individuality. Of what we are as separate beings, we have to become that. It isn't just born whole, like that. When it is born, it's born whole, but it is developed before we can wake up. It has to know this world as much as we need to know it. So we are brought to individuation by steps and stages. At one time, it was through races, then nations, then clans, then families, and now marriages. In marriage, we see the individuality, we see ourselves reflected in the other. The part of ourself that we do not see, we see in the marriage partner. Now, we've mentioned things like cultural spirits and things like that before, and we've just talked about them. But now we can see that they represent different stages in a process. It's just like the garden. You take a shovel first, you turn the soil over, and then you use another tool to break it up, and things get finer and finer until there's complete atomization. This is a process that's going on all the time. In fact, it's a process that is accelerating. And it is a process that is being helped by all sorts of things that we would never believe. The process of individuation and separation from the previous forms in which we were collected is carried out by things like the Rolling Stones and McDonald's. We used to have only a cultural diet, and some people, like the ancient Medish kings, would only drink water out of a certain river. And when they went to fight against the Greeks, they had to bring water thousands of miles for the king to drink. And so the breaking up of the ethnic diet is being accomplished by McDonald's. The same thing with ethnic music by rock and roll. That's enough to break up anything. Gradually, I think, 1,000 languages die every year. And language is one of the strongest tools of the cultural forms. It may be crass, and it may seem like we're producing a blah kind of uniformity, but it really isn't that way at all, because we still have unique individual experiences. And we're finding our unique individual experiences as each one of us having a separate path rather than being tied in to a racial kind of path. So we find larger cultural divisions breaking up more and more. We are going toward a time when we will reunify. But when we reunify, it can only be voluntarily. It can't be that we're forced into a loving spiritual unity. This is what we call in Christianity the kingdom of Christ. But we can't enter into the kingdom of Christ or into the becoming followers of Christ until we are individuated. We have to know ourselves, and we have to know fully what we are and be ourselves before we can offer that to the collective, to the whole, to the one. We get help in all of this. In fact, things I'm going to say in the next few minutes might sound a little bit weird. For example, I believe that racial and cultural spirits are being asked to withdraw their influence. And we have examples of that. And I think one of those examples is Yugoslavia. There are cycles that go back and forth. When things go to the religion or to the right and the Holy Spirit, where the individual is all important, there's more nationalism. When things swing to the left, there is totalitarianism, and there's a kind of unity. Neither is truly like the human spirit or the life spirit, but the things work that way. These are imperfect representations. But Yugoslavia, some people are comfortable under a racial and cultural spirit. And when that spirit is removed from them, the people of Serbia, for example, are intentionally trying to produce a cultural spirit because they feel comfortable and they have strength and power in it. They're not going to succeed because You can't replace an archangel that brings a certain kind of tone to things. You can't replace that with human will. We're much too feeble for that. Another example is Rwanda. There, the racial spirit is being withdrawn, and the people still have their desire natures, and they still have the residual hatreds in their desire natures, and so there is genocide, because when it was under the racial spirits, the archangels would bring wars between them, but so that they would have experiences of just the type they needed. But once the racial spirits are removed and you have only the desire bodies, or as they're removed, then you have things like genocide, where it's an all-out hatred. So what I'm trying to say is that even though there are horrible things in the world, like ethnic cleansing in Yugoslavia or genocides as there was in Rwanda, this is a positive thing. Not that I'm saying that we should all walk out the door and start genocides or something like that. It's a positive thing because it is hastening individuation. It's hastening individuation through very extreme kinds of experiences. And some of those extreme experiences aren't very pleasant. So, for the moment, it seems like the opposite of individuation, and it seems like the opposite of producing uniformity. But that's only an outer appearance. Small-minded materialism and secrecy of the age of Pisces are giving away to the Aquarian age. There are lots of things people are worried about, privacy things. Just think what's going to happen when everybody's clairvoyant. You're not going to have any privacy unless you can retreat to a higher spiritual level. And then your desire for privacy causes you to aspire to higher and higher spiritual levels until you get to the level of life spirit, and there are no secrets for anyone. There doesn't need to be anything for anyone. All right, but we're seeing that many of these things, which appear to be very un-Christian, really are Christian, and they are leading us to where we need to be in terms of individuation. This is radical, but it is important. You know, we have only a certain amount of time that this plane is going to be held together, and it's important that we get to the individuation of our consciousness that parallels the individuation of all the elements and the mineral stuff. It has to be done. And so this is why they make those statements like the axe is laid to the root. And in all of this, there's the other statement that God is not a respecter of persons. The universal spirit doesn't favor one religion or one race one culture over another. Each has its part, and the universal spirit is working through all of them to accomplish this end of individuation for ultimate unification, and ultimate unification so that there can be creative completion, creative fulfillment. It would be much better if we can do what we can to hasten the intent of that. Individuation in ourselves, and doing so by becoming loving beings, does that. Even our spiritual practices do that. As we individuate, the thoughts that we're thinking here tonight, if we can hold them in our consciousness, they radiate through all of society, and it helps the whole process go on. So it behooves us to at least in a little bit think about the esoteric purposes of the activities that are going on in the world around us, so that we can help other people make sense of it. Right now, it's not happening in theology. In theology, the deepest theologians have become atheists. I heard an interview on the radio with a man who is one of the top authorities on the Bible in the world. And he began as a fundamentalist Christian. And the more he studied into the Bible, the more contradictions he found, the more questions he had. And then he started looking at the world itself. And when he looked at the world itself, he came to that big paradox that is a stumbling block for so many people. And that is, either God is evil in allowing evil to take place in the world, or God is not God and does not have the power to stop it. And this is what happens when you have the dualistic material mind as permeates theology. And there isn't that understanding of a spiritual unity, and especially there isn't an understanding of the principle of freedom. The reason that we individuate is to become free creators. This is a very important thing. We're told repeatedly, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The outer agencies were given to us to keep us in line and bring us the kinds of experiences we need. The marriage partner represents the last of those outer agencies. And that outer agency softens us up for receiving or being total in the individuality. If somebody can make appointments for you or open your mail or spend your money or tell you how you're going to spend your time, that softens you up for listening to the still small voice from within yourself. These agencies that we're talking about, especially Libra and partnership, marriage, are highly Aries sign in their nature. How does it go in our country? A nation of the people, by the people, for the people. Something of a human end to the end of producing individual humans. What appears to be in the world with regard to the social activities, everything seems to be going into decadence. There seems to be wholesale immorality. And there is little respect for civil law. And marriages don't last very long at all. If we look at this, this looks at like something that is, things are going to pieces. But when we study mysticism, we have to find the invisible things behind these things and help those things come into being. This is only a step. The future is different from the past. There was a time when you got married because religion said it, the law said it, and you stayed married and you couldn't even be divorced. It was good because I've seen people in those kinds of marriages grow through things that they had to grow through them because they didn't have any choice but to do that. But what we're talking about is something that nothing outside can do for us. Not the law, not social custom, nothing like that. We have to be free in and of ourselves. So, what appears to be decadence is a transfer of attention. Now, I like some of the ideas that are coming out. I like the renewable marriage contract. The renewable marriage contract is when people are married and they say, all right, a year from now, we will negotiate the contract, renegotiate the contract, and there will be bargaining all anew, and if we can't renegotiate a contract, we'll part as friends. I like that, but I like it continued, so that each moment that we renew the contract. There is not such a thing that saved once, saved forever. We want we want consciousness that is universal. We want to be awake, and we want to be awake all of the time. This means that we have to be giving ourselves to our commitment to each other. And if we're to be a real unified whole, this is what friendship is like. We give ourselves no matter what. For the sake of friendship, we'll do it. And that's what that's the way the things are going. It's a commitment. If it's, whether we do it not with each human being, but through all of humanity in the person of a being like Christ, it's the same thing. We renew it, and we renew it all the time. Yesterday's love doesn't do anything for us unless we're living in the past. Even the love of the life spirit that is reflectively projected into this world as love wisdom is new. It's fresh. It's always new. This is how we can tell that we're on the spiritual path, when we look at things that we've seen a thousand times before and they're new. The newness is not in the things outside of us. It's not in the Bible or the Rosicrucian cosmoconception or anything outside of us. The newness is in us. When we unite Mercury and Venus, we get the Uranian kind of consciousness, which is love wisdom. Both have been transformed and metamorphized into something that has the quality of love and the quality of knowledge at the same time. Now, the last time we spoke, we noted that the fixed signs were houses of responsibility because they're rooted in Taurus, but that they were simultaneously houses of freedom, because they ultimately ended in Aquarius. Then through the metamorphic perfection, the trine perfection, we can see that thought and love become love wisdom. The love of Venus bears fruit in the creative love that always makes new and wonderful things. Freedom in love wisdom is a talent. It is the talent. It's the talent of watching and waiting and expecting, anticipating creative love through intuition that comes like a thief in the night. It's a talent that always is alive. Above all else, it's free and it's voluntary. So it may look like there are collapses of institutions and that they're being replaced by other things, but it really is that things are transforming because we are becoming free. In the latter part of St. John's Gospel, Christ washes the disciples' feet. He does this to show that we all serve, and that we're all equals. And after that, he says, henceforth, I call you friends. And then after that, he gives the only definition of a Christian to be found in the four Gospels. He says, they will know that you are mine in that you love one another. We are only Christians in the true sense when we are doing that, when we are loving each other, and when we are freely loving each other because we want to. They will know that you are mine in that you love one another, and that we love in freedom. Let's think about that for a few seconds before all those hundreds of questions come in. Anyone have any questions?
yes, no.
Well, but what's the timeline, I guess, on the whole individuation?
Individuation in completion is a long way off. The timeline for the Aquarian Age is something we discussed in the very first talk.
Okay.
It is in the, somewhere around exact, but it isn't like exact like this door frame is exact. It is somewhere around between 2500 and 2600. Individuation, that depends on each individual. That's what spiritual growth is about. Mm-hmm. That we can willfully bring ourselves to that by understanding and cooperating and allowing ourselves to become individuals.
So, have you read The Tipping Point?
Nope.
We progress as more and more individuals individually. Mm-hmm. When you get to a certain place where there's, you get to a tipping point where the majority have individuated, then what? Then where are we?
I think that there are two points in that. That's a very good thing to think on. One is that the more people that have individuated and lived this way, it's something like spontaneous combustion. That it makes it all the more likely because there's more love in the air, there are more thoughts of truth in the air, and more people are being focused on. But that's the other point, is that those more people outside don't do it for you. You still have to do it yourself. And there's even a danger that you can think that you are that you have accomplished just because you're being carried along, you're basking in the love of others, just as some people bask in the cultural spirits and feel that way. But definitely, the more the people who individuated first, obviously, were the people who were stoned to death because they resisted the group, and they could no longer be part of that. They didn't condemn the group, but the group, for the protection, for the group spirit, tried to hold it all together, and those people got whacked. I don't think that will happen in the future, but the trials become more subtle as we go on. But there is no substitute for doing the work to become individuated yourself. That this has to be on your own. This means, then, that this says something very interesting about the first shall be last and the last shall be first. Mm-hmm. It means that the people who are individuated last will sort of be like younger brothers. They will be cognizant divine beings, but being a cognitive
divine being
has to be respected in love, but that doesn't necessarily mean that one knows everything or can do everything or loves as much as everyone else. It's a graded scale, but it is something that there is a necessary step that has to be taken, and you have to know yourself. The step is, you have to be able to form an idea. And you have to be able to form an idea of the self. Mm-hmm. And you have to be able to form an idea of God. And you have to be able to form an idea of God as self. Mm-hmm. And then live within that, because then you are a divine being, because you have realized what you were in potential and spirit by bringing things to that self-focus.
Mm-hmm. And so the level of suffering that we're at now, and mm-hmm. that seems to be increasing.
Yes, that's a compliment to us.
It's a compliment to us?
Yes, it shows that we're strong enough to redeem more of our past destiny and get more out of it without being broken.
And does that expedite us? I mean, does it? Obviously, it moves us quicker, exponentially quicker. But I mean, do we have control over that, really?
Yes, we have control. It's not like you're thinking a little bit like this is a machine process.
I am.
The control is accomplished by the life that we live. Mm-hmm. The kind of resistance that we get is automatically reflective of where we are at in our spiritual consciousness. The big step is when people learn to work with the process. Most people don't learn from their lives until very late in life or until after the life is over, and then they come back to birth and they're still not completely self-conscious. But once we realize that there are no mistakes, that everything that happens in our life is in some way a part of what we have done ourselves, and that it is part for us to be responsible and to know ourselves through everything we've experienced, and much of that has been pretty crappy stuff we've done, when we get to that point, it's significantly different. And when humanity becomes aware of that, even if they are not completely individuated in knowing themselves as a divine being, they are still progressing much more rapidly because they are taking a conscious responsibility for their life and they're looking for meaning in life rather than looking for the best new microbrewery or something of that nature. Mm-hmm. You had a question.
How do you square a renewable marriage contract with Saturn's exaltation in Libra?
I don't see any problem with that. I don't know that Saturn says that necessarily. You have to honor your commitments, but it doesn't say that the commitment has to be once for all. Saturnian people like that kind of a commitment, but it doesn't have to be that way.
Why would it have to be renewable? Why get married at all?
That's happening more and more
in Europe.
Yes.
Because they don't have to worry about the kind of things we have to worry about here, you know.
If I believe that's
the civil, law stuff.
Yes. I believe that is what the Bible says when it says, let your yeas be yeas and your nays be nays, that you live in the principle of truth. Then you don't need to have an institution like marriage. But if you have a commitment with someone, we're talking about intermediary stages. Yeah. We're talking about going from a stage where everything in society has forced people to be together to a stage where people make a commitment to each other for the sake of children or for the sake of accomplishing some end working together to the point where people will live all of the time in truth, and that they will, in a common spiritual sympathy, work together, and there would be no thought of separation because it would be like the denial of love working in us.
It's the binding quality of the commitment, though, that forces the growth.
Yeah, right now, yes, but it isn't as strong as when that is replaced by love. That's the whole principle we're trying to get to tonight. Mm-hmm. That what you do from love in friendship is much stronger than what you have to do because you're going to get sued if you don't.
Well, that comes as part of the growth.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't think we have any arguments. No, she said maybe.
But something that's renewable is not as binding. So you don't have the same binding quality.
Oh, yes, it is.
Well, divorce is so easy now.
Maybe renewable isn't the right word. Continuous spontaneity, where you're in the moment always, that you're continuously living in the moment spontaneously. And if there are any goals or something like that, that's continuously in the consciousness. But that's a step further on. I just talked about the marriage where you recommit again and again is a step in that direction. I was getting toward the end and I was trying to race.
Well, it's kind of like an exit strategy in a business relationship. And that's maybe what you're,
She's opting for more perpetual commitment. Even perpetual isn't the right word. Mm-hmm. Permanent commitment.
Like you can't.
I'm saying that permanent commitment.
You see, I have Saturn in the seventh house.
Yeah, I have it there too.
You're saying permanent commitment kills.
Well, permanent commitment is once for all, and
is what?
It once for all time.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and it doesn't have the fresh newness.
Right, kills
To argue from her point of view, there is a point. This is something that traditionally, this is one of the things that causes a lot of problems. The Bible is a spiritual book. And sometimes when they're talking about marriage in a way once forever, they are talking about the alchemical marriage between the personality and the individuality, and that is a marriage once forever. Mm-hmm. Like once your lower nature and your personal being says, yes, I will serve the spirit forever and ever, that is a permanent that way. But
if the Bible's written for many levels of understanding, it's true on many levels.
Yes, yeah. But it sure gave me a horrendous thing when I was going to marry my wife, and she had already been married once before, not understanding some of those other levels. I was with trepidation that I got married. That was just a warning of a different kind that I didn't recognize. Okay.